Listening to WOOP-LP, Cleveland, Tennessee. WOOP FM is a broadcasting service of the Traditional Music Resource Center, and we play America's original music.
Good morning, everyone. Welcome to WOOP FM and its new program, Make It Grow. It's a joint project of the Bradley County Master Gardeners Program and WOOP Radio. And Deb, introduce our special guest here to talk about making things grow today.
Good morning. We have Myron McCleary and Dave Hopper with us today, and we're going to talk about a lot of fun things associated with growing things, and these guys can answer your questions.
We're going to focus on vegetables, and it's that time of the year. And
so are you going to ask them, Ron, about your Brussels sprouts? Ron grew Brussels sprouts,
no,
guys.
I grew plants last year. I grew no Brussels sprouts.
And he got one Brussels sprout about the size of a marble on these beautiful, beautiful plants.
Oh, the plant. What happened, Myron?
Well, there's a couple of different things that could happen with Brussels sprouts. We have a crop growing right now, and they are humongous, green, lush. And I was just asking my wife the other day, I said, what are these things going to put on? And as I said that, I started seeing the little nubs come on the vine. Yes. So one of the things I think is very important is the right time of the year to plant. Mm-hmm. Many folks will actually plant early spring, and then some folks will choose early fall. You can grow both times, but we need to make sure there is a good nitrogen source for those, because there is just so much greenery to make the plant grow.
Same thing with broccoli.
Broccoli is another. Now, one of the things that we have with broccoli is that many times individuals will say, well, my broccoli is being ate up by loppers. And that happens early spring most of the time. So I always encourage people to plant broccoli in the fall and make sure you get it in early enough. And I think that you will have a great crop.
Now, you say early spring. That's not January, is it?
No, we're early spring. I'm talking about you can actually start some of your cool season crops starting in February, but I would wait till about March, and you'll see a lot of the transplants being put out unless you're going to try to start your own transplants indoors.
Mm-hmm. Now, I have broccoli growing right now, and it's starting to get the
The
heads, yeah. Mm-hmm. And there's some that big around now, so I don't know. Is that too late, or should they already be bigger?
No. He was illustrating that they're about 2.5 inches in diameter at this point in time. And I think that it's not too late or too early, but the thing about it is, how tender do you want the plant to be? Mm-hmm. It looks like that would be an ideal size for you to chop off and going in and steam and have a luscious dinner. And as you'll see, after you do that, you'll have other side shoots grow from that.
Okay.
Oh, okay.
Dave, what do you have growing right now?
Well, actually, I've had great success with my broccoli this spring. I planted broccoli transplants as soon as I found them in the stores. I planted them, I think, around March the 1st. And I've been harvesting broccoli probably for, I'm going to say, 3 weeks, and I've got 8 plants out, and I've got them in raised beds. And when it was real cold, I do have a frame over them. The cold weather doesn't really affect them that much, but I cover them with plastic, and I've been harvesting beautiful heads, and I don't remember what variety that I actually planted, but I've harvested heads, and I've got luscious side heads that come up on the side of the plants, and I hadn't had that before. And these are, I think it's my raised beds and the nutritious soil I have that's doing that. But I'm in a hurry now to get my broccoli moved on out, because that broccoli doesn't like hot weather very well. It'll bolt. And I personally think the fall is the best time to plant. But I've had great success, so I'll do it again next spring.
In the fall, when it's fall, I mean, it's hot here even into September. So is that too early?
September the 1st is what I use. Because it's hot, you're right, and you will have maybe some worm damage. But if you can make it through September, nurturing those plants, you're going to have, by Thanksgiving, you're going to be really pleased with your crop.
Okay, now when we say winter crops, are we talking about potatoes, onions, any kind of root crop? Or
Not necessarily. Not all things are going to survive like that. We have to look at how long it takes for that plant to actually grow. Most of the time, if we have a cool season crop, such as beets and onions and garlics and those types of things and potatoes, then we can actually also try to plant that once again for a fall crop.
Mm-hmm.
But all things, not necessarily so, that it will.
Now, would potatoes be a fall? Can they be a fall crop?
Could
too?
Be a fall crop.
No, I've never planted
Irish potatoes. I know. Let's differentiate. Irish potatoes you can actually have a fall crop. Sweet potatoes, because it takes a little bit longer for them to actually grow, most of the time we don't have a second crop of those.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Now, asparagus a good thing to grow in the fall?
Asparagus is, Ron, is a crop where you need to have it in a separate place. And that's going to be a perennial, and every year it will come back. But you need to separate it in an asparagus bed, and you can actually tend it as that.
Why do you do that? Why do you separate it?
Because it propagates by as a rhizome, which mm-hmm. you have roots underground,
mm-hmm.
and it spreads in that particular manner. So you don't want it out there in your garden place, so you're going to actually have a disruption all the time. So you want it in having one spot, and the roots stay viable.
Do you guys plant things by the signs?
I plant usually when I'm ready to plant, and you know, a lot of people do, and it works. A lot of people don't, and it works. So I'm not really
onto the signs. Well, I bet you, Myron.
But I wouldn't argue against it.
No, right.
My father, he told me to always plant by the signs. But most of the time, I plant when it's opportune.
Yes.
Opportune moment, I go out there and I start planting.
Yeah.
But I do think there is a big difference, especially when you're talking below ground and above ground crops.
So you know, probably just more weather related.
Planting's not been my problem. It's getting things to grow. It's been I can plant anytime. But folks, you're listening to Make It Grow here on Whoop FM. You can call us here at 614-5553 if you have any question. We're talking about vegetable garden today, but if you have questions about lawns, trees, shrubs, how to get rid of skunks, we can tell you if they get under your house, just move.
Yep.
That might be the best thing to do, particularly if they die. But, give us a call here at 614-5553.
What about strawberries? If I wanted strawberries year after year, what would I need to do? Do I have to replant them every year?
You don't have to, but I've recently toured Frank Taylor's strawberry farm out on Michigan Avenue, and I was surprised to find out that he does replant his crop every year. And I think he said he planted 15,000 strawberry plants this year, and they're beautiful. But I asked him, I can't actually remember his response, but I asked him why he replanted every year and not self-propagate. And I think he was worried about maybe a disease or something happening, so he orders them every year and replants. Now for the homeowner, I'd say I would propagate my own or use my own.
Now, this is harvest time for strawberries, correct?
It is. It depends on where you're at. The farther south, the harvest moves north. And I think Cleveland, unless somebody differs, is probably real close to now. We got some strawberries just the other day, and I think they were from Maryville. So, and, of course, they may have been raised in a greenhouse or something to get started, but they're really good. And, of course,
I
to
know
me,
Dayton's
locals,
having their strawberry festival this weekend, so that's usually a sign to me.
I'd say the time's right.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
I just want to say something along with what Dave has just said. I attending a festival up in Cumberland, or Crossville, and one of the UT specialists was telling us that it is best if you replant every year for the strawberries. And you get rid of disease, you get rid of all the other things that are actually invasive to the to the plant, and the crops are much more
so heavier. If you're doing it for a living, you would probably replant.
And commercial growing anything is a little bit different than Joe Blow, homeowner like myself, doing small raised beds, or Myron, he's doing, I guess, traditional gardening in a way. But
one of you guys thought about farming or growing anything, Bradley County was a huge producer of strawberries. Huge.
We did a program on one of our Old Town Cleveland shows just about strawberries. And a lot of the guys who had been involved in it, and it was unbelievable how many plants. And they developed a large cooling packing house here in Cleveland to ship strawberries out of here at one time.
Mm-hmm. Ron, is there still strawberries to be picked here in the Cleveland area, Bradley County area?
I don't know, not
as much as it was at one time. No, mm-hmm. No. Mm-hmm. I think there's more commercial growers.
What Mr. Lehman out on Michigan Avenue Road might have strawberries.
What is a good crop to grow here in Bradley County? First off, I have learned in my master gardening class. I'm the apprentice now. Get your soil checked. If you don't know what your soil is doing, then you can't grow. It takes a different soil for tomatoes than it would for a pepper, or they could be the same, you know. But you have your soil tested for what you're going to grow, and they can give you what to put in the soil. Doesn't get better unless you add composted to it, and it improves it. But the soil laying there, just putting fertilizer in it, does not improve the soil. The soil just holds the fertilizer. Have I learned well?
I think you have.
Well, what's a good crop to grow here concerning the type of soil we have in this area? Tons of pine needles here.
Yeah, there is. If I look at the – I think it would depend on where you live. Mm-hmm. And that's the reason people say soil test. If I move from one space to another space, then the pH of the soil may be totally different. We have a lot of limestone in our area, so that means that it's the pH may be a little bit higher. But then again, if I move someplace else, it could be a lower pH. I would stick with what your theory is: soil test, and it saves you money, it saves you time, and it's going to save you a lot of energy in the long run.
So, what crop is good here, though? What do you like? What do you think grows good in Bradley County?
I don't know if there's any one crop, but I know a crop that people like. You know, they like tomatoes. They like
Maters.
Green beans.
Maters.
Maters. They like green beans. They like corn.
Yes.
All those things grow well, but I do think that you'll have to amend the soil depending on where you live.
Yeah, because now tomatoes, I've read that, you know, you shouldn't put your bell peppers and tomatoes together because there's something about they don't like each other. Is that true? I read that somewhere.
I've
been in my master gardener class.
I think that there are some families of plants that we tend to try to plant together.
Mm-hmm.
If I'm looking at the tomato family, then I look at tomatoes, potatoes, peppers, all grow in that particular family. And then if we look at some other types of families, we look at the root crops, which is beets and carrots and onions and garlic. Those, and what we find from that is that those like families attract like bugs, and so we can actually kind of defend off some of the invasion of the pests by planting those in the families. But one of the things I want to say too is that we don't want to plant the same family in the same plot year after year. We want to rotate it so that we have a better outcome.
So you don't want to plant your tomato in that same favorite spot every year?
No.
Okay, tell us why.
You're going to have invasion of pests,
mm-hmm.
and they'll get into the soil. They'll get in. They'll just almost like attract to that particular area because that's what they like.
Mm-hmm.
So if I move it, then we have another pest that's going to, or that pest will be there, but the other plant, it just won't be able to survive because we don't have the same type of vegetation there.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yeah. And the other thing about those things, one of the things I do want to say is that when you have a vegetable garden, one of the things that is most dangerous to that garden is to have a lot of weeds, because weeds attract pests also.
That's what I grow so good.
Yeah.
I'm really
right
good
now
at that.
We have poison ivy in our flower beds. How do I get rid of that stuff? Someone help me with that.
Digging it out, if it's large.
It's large. It's in charge.
Well, if it's large and in charge, you're probably going to have to try to dig it out. Best do not burn it.
Okay, yeah.
Because it retains the poison. I don't really recall the name of the poison, but you're going to have to pile it somewhere and forget it. But I personally would spray it if it was bothering me that bad. Yeah, I'd cut the stalk, then if the stump started.
It's coming out of our English ivy.
Mm. Well, I'd pull it up if I could.
Yeah.
And, of course, use gloves.
We've pulled it up, but every year it comes back.
You got to get the roots yeah. out. And the roots migrate. I'm really not sure how far, but if you just start pulling the roots.
And it's right by our front porch, too. So we got poison ivy and English ivy.
And it was like nothing was there, and then now there's, ugh.
So. Yeah, yeah. So, Dan, I know you do some, Dave, excuse me, Dan, composting. Give us a little idea of what we need to do to help our tomatoes and peppers grow better. What can a average gardener at home, what can they do to make their soil better?
Well, amend it is the biggest. That's why I went to raised beds. If you've got the resources and a place to do the raised beds, you can keep a high-quality growth soil in a small place. In a traditional garden, I think you're basically walking on 80% of your growth space, and that's what's basically put me off of a traditional garden. Now, I think a trench garden is great, where you dig a small trench and amend that trench with compost and good growing soil, and then you can walk parallel to the trench, but plowing a whole field, then you end up walking on 80% of it. Weeds are in there. That's put me off of traditional, like I've got a half acre. That's a lot of work. But if you got some small beds, you can really amend them, and you can grow a lot of stuff in a small space.
Now, when you say a raised bed, now, does somebody think that's 3 foot high? Or tell me what you mean by a raised bed. You know, it doesn't have to be a big wooden frame around it and be 3 foot high or anything.
No. I think when you start looking, some people will say a 6-inch tall frame by 4 by 8 or no wider than 4 feet, because you got to be able to access the bed from all sides. Mm-hmm. 4 by 8, 4 by 12, or 2 by 8. My particular ones are 4 by 4, and mine are 10 inches or 11 inches tall. I think 6 inches is a little bit too short. There's a couple of books on the market now. They recommend 6-inch tall beds, but I think that's too short. I just think some roots need more space than that.
Well, but, particularly in our area, because our soil is only 4 or 6 inches deep of topsoil in Bradley County traditionally.
Well, the problem is you may not have good soil at all. So if you don't have good soil, I wouldn't worry about going to getting a soil test on bad that you can just look at it and tell it's not. Now, you can't look at it and compete with a soil test, but you can tell if it's not going to grow or not. So,
no, where if it's that red clay and got rock in it, it probably ain't going to grow.
I would definitely get some amendment, and once you get your soil built up, then each year you follow back with some more compost, and that's what got me into composting. I've got a small compost tumbler that I use, and I add to it greens and browns, and I tumble it from household vegetable waste, garden clippings, and stuff of that nature.
Well, now if you're building those 4x4 beds, say you build 4x4 beds, that first time you probably ain't gonna have enough compost to fill that up yourself, no matter how much kitchen scraps you have.
You won't. Now, what I personally did, I went to one of the local landscape companies, and I got a grow mix, and it's basically a blend of a mushroom compost, topsoil, and sand, and I amend that with peat moss, some vermiculite, and some household organic fertilizer. I have worm castings as well that I use, because another one of the hobbies I got into is raising red worms, and that's kind of one of the things I said I would never do, but I'm doing it, and I use a little bit of worm castings. But again, I'm doing it on a small scale. I can't do it in a large scale. It's a hobby thing for me, and I get a lot of satisfaction out of the raised bed techniques.
Do you think that to that, Myra?
Well, not really, but one of the things that I'm doing too, I started probably 2 years ago of doing raised beds, and my beds are 8x4. And I have a series of probably 6 of those. And I found that by doing that, I could actually raise just about as much produce in those 6 beds as I could if I were doing the traditional garden in a larger spot. So I Dave is right on target with that. There is one drawback with raised beds, and I really want to tell people up front, is that when you have raised beds, you have to water. And usually I find a cycle of about every 3 days that you have to water, because plants need about an inch of water per week, as a general rule.
And so if it rains 5 inches a day, that doesn't still do it, though, because that 5 inches of water gets gone real fast.
Exactly.
So you still have to come back every couple of days and still supplement it.
Exactly.
Now, can you use your just tap water, or would, or is there a better way of doing that?
Well, tap water is fine. I am a person that has started to do rain barrels.
Mm-hmm.
And rain barrels are, you know, we're using all of what God's given us. And we're just recycling, and we're making the best of it. And so, I would strongly encourage, if you don't have a rain barrel, it's very easy to make one and to utilize those resources for
how do you make system. A rain barrel?
Well, I take a 55-gallon drum.
A plastic drum.
I will cut a hole in the top, put a spigot on the bottom, and then I will have a pipe leading from my guttering system that comes down into that through a sieve, so I can get up all the leaves and debris. Mm. And then I have my water.
How do you water out of that, Myron? Do you use a watering pail, or do you have a gravity feed system that self-waters? Or how do you manage the watering from the barrel to the plants?
Both. I can use a pail system, or it's up higher than the garden. And so I can actually use gravity and just turn on the spigot, and it comes down and waters the area.
Do you ever run low on water when it gets in the summertime when you really need the water?
Oh, yes. And that's where I would go back to using traditional waters from the house. Mm-hmm. Whatever they have to have water. Yeah.
So how much water coming off your roof fills up that 55 gallon? Does it take a lot more than you think?
No, actually you get more water, and there is an overflow valve on there where the water is actually spewing out. It mm-hmm. takes very little. You would think that there's, you know, is this going to be enough water? You will get more than enough water coming off your mm-hmm. house. And there are a number of different areas that are looking into conventional methods of capturing that water, putting it into a cistern system, and then pumping that water back out mm-hmm. so they can actually use it again.
Mm-hmm. Very interesting. Yeah. Very interesting. Okay. So, and you can, by the way, buy those barrels down at Habitat for Humanity.
Yeah, they got some blue plastic ones down there, mm-hmm. about $10 a piece right now.
Oh, fantastic.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
We bought one. It's sitting there waiting for us to do something creative with it. we ain't got there yet.
I think elevation is your friend, because if you put them on the mm-hmm. ground, you're going to find you're going to have a tough time getting the water out of the mm-hmm. bottom of the barrel if it's at ground level.
What about like a little pool pump that you could pump over to it? You know, that now some of them only pump so far, mm-hmm. so you got to look at the bigger the pump, the farther the distance.
But, yeah. There was one of our master gardener friends had a pump system where it was actually pumping the water out of the barrel and then using that back into the watering system. So I think that's you could do that too.
It wouldn't take much of a lift. It wouldn't have to be up very high to make that, you know, the gravity to work for you.
Yeah, it don't take much
you
at
just
all.
Have to be patient when you're watering, because it's just going to be leaking out.
Yeah.
I saw something, guys, y'all would have been interested in a couple years ago. I had the opportunity to go down with a very knowledgeable person and tour Moccasin Bend, the island, Moccasin Bend, the part of the property that the U.S. government has purchased, thankfully, and are going to preserve that. But some of the terraces are still down there, if you know what you're looking for. And it was really a surprise to me, with all those big flatlands, that the Cherokee would have been growing crops on the hilly parts of that. But I thought it was very interesting, and he was knowledgeable enough he could point them out. And when when somebody pointed it out to me, I could see it too. But I thought that was really interesting, that quite an advanced civilization, actually.
Mm. Is it time now to plant everything? All your summer crops, is it time, or is it we late, or should we be doing it now?
I think you can plant now. I think now's a great time for anything in the summer. And I'm not sure when's the last time to plant summer crops, because my tomatoes typically all get tired and come August. They still have tomatoes on them, but the plant's starting to look fatigued. So I have a question is, if you planted a second crop, what's the latest date you can plant a second crop? And now I'm going to put that to Myron. I don't know if he ever does two crops of tomatoes, but I'm suggesting maybe mid-June. I haven't done it before because usually I'm tired of gardening by then.
But. I did that last year and just had a second crop for the squirrels. Squirrels destroyed every tomato plant I had last year.
We had this pesky little squirrel that would pick every tomato and come and sit in and look in our windows at us as it's chewing on it, and then he'd throw it down and go get another one. So we're going to have to deal with him this year if he's still back.
Well, does anybody have their own special variety of tomato that they like? I'm kind of confused because I'm growing heirlooms, and I've probably got 8 or 10 different varieties of heirlooms I planted from seeds, and it's kind of an experiment with me. And the way I've heard, heirlooms doesn't produce like hybrids do. So, but anyway, that's my experience right now. And at some point in time, I may narrow it down to one or two, then go back to some hybrids.
So
I'm not
just
sure.
Just pick your favorite.
But one of the things, Dave, that I think that my favorite is German Johnsons. I don't know if you have German Johnsons or not, but they are a knotty looking tomato, but the flavor is outstanding. We share most of our tomatoes, and we are heirloom tomato growers also. There's Brandywines, which is a good one. There's a black tomato that is very, very good.
Black cream.
The list just goes on and on. But one of the things I want to go backward a little bit and look at the time frame of your tomatoes. Tomatoes can depend how long it takes for that tomato to mature. Some of them are 55 days, some are 60 days, some are 70. So what we traditionally want to do, we want to back up our tomato to the first frost, which is in our area usually around October the 15th. So we want, if your tomato is going to produce by that time, we can actually start it.
Start it in mid, like, yeah. And then seeds
we,
now.
Yeah, and then we have a tomato that is, you know, producing before the first frost. Mm-hmm. Or sometimes, even if the tomatoes are green, we can harvest the tomatoes, take them indoors, and then let them ripen indoors.
Okay.
The other thing that many folks are doing, they're looking at some type of coverage for their tomatoes, such as a portable greenhouse. They can start them in there or move the greenhouse back over to the tomatoes, and then you have a tomato that may be lasting on into November, December time frame. Mm-hmm. So all those are different options. But there are two different types of tomatoes also, and we need to think about this. There are tomatoes that are called determinate and indeterminate tomatoes. Indeterminate, they have no ceiling. They will just continue to grow, and they'll produce at different times throughout the growing year. And then there are the determinants, which tend to come in and produce one great big batch of tomatoes, and they're done. So we need to think about that also when we were.
Well, I've always
selecting.
Planted determinants. They've always ran. I use bamboo canes for my poles, and I've got some of them 7 foot tall. And by the end of the season, the tomatoes have gone to the top and come back down. So I've got a couple determinants this year that I'm trying, and if they work well, I may. Next year plant determinants, then 6 weeks later go with some other determinants to get a second. And I think commercial growers basically use determinants to get their crop in the field, get it up and get it harvested, and they're through with it. They don't have to continue to monitor a non-determinate plant or indeterminate plant for the reasons that they just keep producing and they want to be through with it.
And a lot of greenery, and with that greenery, it takes more nitrogen.
Right.
So that's another factor about
making. Okay, for us. For those people who just planted those 3 or 4 tomato plants, they go down to the big box stores and they just get some Miracle-Gro. Is that going to be all right? Miracle-Gro by a brand. There are other brands too, just
fertilizer.
As far as fertilizing,
yes.
Okay. First of all, I'm not a big advocate of fertilizing. I will say that. But for tomatoes, we have to be very. Sensitive as to how we fertilize, because if you fertilize a tomato at the wrong time, you will get lots of growth and no tomatoes. But you can use that. Usually a rule of thumb is that when a tomato starts to set and the tomato is about the size of a quarter to 50 cents, then you can side dress that tomato and then you may increase the harvest. But do not do it when there's just greenery, because you'll get nothing but growth and no tomatoes.
See, I've got a crop of snow peas now. Then they're 4 foot tall, and they're just now producing blooms. And I have a feeling my soil was too rich in nitrogen, because it's grown a tremendous amount of vine. But that's where you get into a problem with having too rich a soil with nitrogen specifically. I think the nitrogen promotes the green growth, and you need the potassium and potash to aid in the fruit production. So that's a lesson learned maybe on the snow peas.
So something that, you know, the Master Gardener, they give us a big Bible here of plants. But if you just go on the internet and type in snow peas or tomatoes, and you put your brand, and they will tell you, and you may find 7 or 8 different opinions, and sort of read the one that you want to use and see if it works. But, you know, is that, when should you do this? When should you do that? Should you use this? And, of course, you know, we all see the Miracle-Gro commercials. I'm not knocking Miracle-Gro itself, but that seems to be the leader in the
just industry.
Just me going down there and buying some fertilizer to throw out there and see what happens, you know, and that's what I have done. And I have not been a great gardener. You know,
well,
I didn't listen to my grandfather, which, you know, he had those perfect rows and huge crops. I didn't pay attention.
One caution I would add to looking stuff on the internet. Internet's a great source of information.
Yeah.
But when it comes to snow peas, Brussels sprouts, broccoli, you're going to get a lot of information from the northern latitudes. We're in zone 7. And the information is still valid, but some of the timing may be different.
Mm-hmm.
So just be aware of the growing zone that we're in, because we go hot real fast. The northern climates where they grow Brussels sprouts, they grow all the cool weather crops, but their growing season's longer and it's slower. Mm-hmm. Here it starts bursting. And I think one reason Brussels sprouts have a problem, I think their growth season is like 110 days. They're a long harvest time. Mm-hmm. Broccoli's what, 65 days or 70, something in that area. So if it gets hot on your plants, if you plant them in spring, you're finished. If you plant them in the fall, then it's going to get so cold they quit growing. So that's mm-hmm. our zone. We can grow about anything here, but successfully for it to reharvest and rejuvenate its own seed, and that's what a plant desires to do, is make its own seed again. Our growing zone sometimes doesn't provide that. That's why our timing has to be more important, maybe with zone 7.
Yeah, if you look on the back of those seed pump, you know, if you buy a pack of seeds, it'll tell you what zone you're in and that. And also, I think the UT Agricultural has a website, and you can probably go that and would find out better about what happens in Tennessee. You know,
I think that's very important, because one of the things about the UT Extension website is that it is Tennessee specific.
Mm-hmm.
And that gives us a better piece of information as far as what we could grow. Also, I do know that if there are organic field trials, there are some vegetables that they have tried and true experience with. So they're passing that information along with you also, so you can actually visit there and get a variety of seed or plant that's going to do well for you in this area.
Bottom of the tomato plant, I mean, the tomato turned black, white, rots out. What is that? The tomato forms really nice, and then the bottom starts rotting out.
I've heard it's calcium deficiency.
Okay.
Or too much water. Last year was a terrible, at least my experience, and I think I've talked to others, it was a terrible growing experience for tomatoes because of all the rain we had. I keep a rain gauge, and I think I measured 72 point some odd inches for the whole year last
36,
year. And it didn't finish till mid-July or somewhere in there. We just had a tremendous, terrible growing because of the water. So water could do the black spot for sure, too much water. So all soils need to be well drained. And I didn't have my tomatoes in a raised bed, and I don't this year, but maybe one or two I do. But that's one advantage of me to raise bed. It does drain fast, so if we get a lot of water, it may go away. But at the same time, you got to water 2 days later.
You guys were talking about heirloom plants versus hybrid. An heirloom, you can replant those seeds out of that piece of fruit or that tomato or whatever, and it will grow that same vegetable the next year.
Mm-hmm.
But hybrid, it might not grow, and you don't know what you're going to get.
Well,
would that be a simple explanation of that?
It is, and I found a favorite tomato I buy in the grocery store that I'm trying to repropagate the seeds from this year. I got the plants going, but I'm pretty sure it's a hybrid, but I'm afraid I'm going to get something like a Tomato or some small mm-hmm. little mm-hmm. off tomato. But I'm experimenting just to prove it myself, mm-hmm. and we'll see how that comes out. But you can reproduce your tomatoes from heirlooms from keeping the seed. Hybrids, you can't traditionally.
Mm-hmm. I know that my dad had seeds. We went all the way to North Carolina to visit relatives, and he gave my dad seeds. And my dad, for years, grew those crops, and then I don't know what happened to the seeds, and now I wish I knew. Because it was really tall corn and fun things to grow, but worked well.
Okra, folks, getting okra. It started. I know I've been told everything in the world, soak your seeds in palmolive things. What's the secret of getting okra started in growing? I mean, do you just plant the seed in the ground, or do you start them, do you soak them overnight, or...
There's a couple of things I tend to do. Number one, I pick the right time of year to try to start them. Okra is a very warm. It needs some heat to get started. But to get that thing started a little bit better, you can do a couple of different things. There's some tricks that I've learned over the years. You can take some okra seed, put it in a jar with a piece of sandpaper, just enough, and shake that jar so it scorates the outer area of the seed. That's one way. And then you can also soak them, and then that helps them. And don't soak them for a long period of time. Overnight should be fine, and then let them start to dry out a little bit, and then plant them. And make sure you plant them at the right depth. Most folks, the major problem that folks have is that they plant too deeply, and then the seed don't come up. So those three things I would like to employ for folks to
how
try.
How deep?
About an inch.
Oh.
Okay. Okra is a do better because it's a taller plant, remember, and then you don't want the plant to fall over. Traditionally, and this is the theory, you always want to plant a seed twice the diameter or two times the diameter of the seed, and that's the widest point. Mm-hmm. So that's a general rule, but for okra, you see, that's a little bit deeper than that.
Yeah, because I've tried to grow it, and one year you grow it and it's good, next year I can't get it to come out of the ground.
That may be just the temperature, the soil temperature.
Okay. I think, and so he gets excited and wants to plant it early, and
you know, it's February,
cool.
You know, it's time to plant.
Yeah.
No.
And I have read that you can soak the okra seed in a mild bleach solution, but for maybe a period of hours, and I've not tried that. But I think the whole core of it is breaking down that outer shell to get the inside exposure to some moisture.
Mm-hmm.
And I think a lot of people plant seeds that probably put the seeds in, and when they start to germinate, they don't water. The seeds are so shallow, typically, unless they're large seeds, they don't get enough moisture. And they got to have a continuous moisture supply. They're infants, and they need to have the moisture to get started. Mm-hmm. And if you just set it and forget it, you may fail that way because you mm-hmm. not of an insufficient moisture supply.
Do you guys grow potatoes?
What type of potatoes?
what do you
any kind?
I do.
What do you grow?
Irish potatoes. You mean the variety?
Mm-hmm.
Usually, Kennebecks are probably one of the most common. And there is a red skin potato.
How do you just plant them in the ground, or do you use the straw? Some people grow them in straw and just do stuff like that.
I have a direct plant in the soil. Now with potatoes, and I don't know what your train of teaching has been, but I cut a potato. Mm-hmm. You have to cut them with so many eyes, and the eyes are those little outgrowths mm-hmm. on the potato that are another root system that could actually take place. And I usually cut them where there's going to be at least two eyes on each mm-hmm. Piece, and then I plant those. And many times people say, plant them anywhere from 6 inches deep. I tend to go with around four, and then cover those well and hope that we get some moisture, and then go from there.
Mm-hmm. We had purchased sweet potato plants one year and thinking we were getting the ornamental type, and we got the regular potato type, and I had flower beds full of potatoes.
We had sweet potatoes in our flower pots.
Uh-huh. And it was pushing the pots up. I mean, the flowers up out of the pots. But we didn't care. We just
knew
about it.
They were pretty, though, right?
It was
they
wonderful.
They were very good. Yeah, yeah. We ate them. Yeah.
Now, sweet potatoes are a warm weather crop.
Mm-hmm. Uh-huh.
Regular potatoes are a cool weather crop. I say regular. Irish potatoes, Yukon goes. Typically, that type of potato. But sweet potato is considered a warm weather crop, mm-hmm. and I think right now is probably a good time to plant those as well, mm-hmm. if you can find the plants. I've not done them from seed, but
I went up to the Amish farm and got some sweet potatoes about a week or so ago. They had plants out.
The sets or the actually the potato?
No, the plants.
Okay. They had them up at the...
Another thing about sweet potatoes, that's another, you need some real loose soil. Because as the potato grows, it's going to expand. If your soil is clay and rock, you're going to have some awful deformed potatoes, and plus it won't grow very well. Yeah. If you've got... I like my soil where I can harvest it with my hands. Yeah. If you can harvest potatoes with your hands, you've got some... The consistency of the soil is good.
Pretty true of all root crops, though, isn't it? Don't they need some room
elbow
to grow?
Elbow room. I call it elbow room. Carrots especially.
All right. Let me ask about onions. Onions is something I've never had great success on. I've tried and played around with them, but now you get the little onion bulb, you know, you go down here to the store and buy it, and I've been told you put half of it in the ground and half all the way in the ground, but then grow these great green onions coming out here, but I never get an onion on the bottom. I still have that onion. I plant it. What's going on?
You're buying the wrong sets.
It may be the wrong kind of onion. I'm not sure. But if you leave them long enough, they will start to produce a head if it's that type of onion.
I bought sweet onions this year. And I've got, beautiful. You know, they're up tall and everything like that.
They're
and
not I pulled quite one that the other tall.
Day. Well, they're not, it's not time. I don't think it's time to harvest the bulbs. I'm not sure when's the harvest time, Myron. When they harvest the sweet onions in Georgia, for instance, is that late summer?
I would think so.
The bulb has to grow. It's going to form a bulb, then it's going to expand. Now, how it expands, I'm not sure what kind of fertilizer you use on the onions to promote the head growth, but that may be part of it.
And one of the things you need to keep in mind about the onions is if we're talking about onions like hamburger-sized onions,
yes.
that if that's what you're looking for, there's a couple of different things you can do. Now, think about onions as a crop that wants a lot of nitrogen. They love nitrogen. So that's one thing. The other thing is that when you buy your little sets, you need to separate your sets into small and large, because the smaller the set, usually the larger the onion. And what we want to do is we don't want to plant them so deep that we have a lot of problems with the expansion. So one of the things you can do after that onion starts to develop, you can take any little object and rake around that onion so it has some room to expand. And then the onion expands above ground, and that's what you really want. But the onions that are in Georgia, they are very dependent on the soil type of that area. That's what makes them real, real sweet and those types of things too. So there's a lot of different things that are involved with this onion thing. So you have to take one little thing at a time. And what I would recommend for you is look at your sets, look at the pH of the soil, and you may have to do some amendments, and then make sure that the bulb is not totally underground. You want to scrape around it and then let it expand above ground.
So I thought it all still had to be underground.
No,
the root system.
The root system. Okay.
Yeah.
Well, I think when you drive through Vidalia, you'll see the fields. You can actually see the onions sitting. It looks like they're sitting on top of the ground, because that soil will be raked away. They may do that by hand. I don't know how the whole process works.
So are they a warm? They like the heat.
Yeah.
Okay.
I was just visiting a garden or a farm up in East Tennessee, and they were growing onions in hoop houses. And they were using Texas sweets, and the onions were just unbelievable. They were huge, and all of them were grown under plastic, but just barely sitting in the ground, and they were the most huge onions that I've ever seen. Great onions. Flavor was absolutely
I think I want to go on
too.
Field trips with Myron.
Yeah.
Sounds like a lot of fun.
Someone's calling here with us. We've got a question for you. Good morning. You're live on Make It Grow.
Hello, Ron and Debbie.
Hey, Miss Ella. How you doing?
Well, I don't have nothing planted. Only one time I planted something. That was in California. And I planted tomatoes in the shade, and they never got red, so I had fried green tomatoes.
There you go.
Well, that's good, too.
So So
I thought you were going to you grew some of that wacky tobacco there or something.
No, I never smoked.
Well, that's good. Well, did you go to Pokey's last night?
Yeah, but I came right back home because I couldn't stand it over there.
Why?
Because I ain't speaking to somebody.
Uh-oh. You haven't had a spat with a lover?
No, he's not my lover. He's just a friend.
Oh, okay. How many beers you drank before you left, though?
Huh?
How many beers did you drink before you left?
None.
None.
Oh. Nine?
Nine or none?
None.
Okay. Well, Miss Ella, we're going to have to get off of here. We'll talk to you later, okay?
Well, I just wanted to say that the post, you know, the guys that deliver the mail, they're taking canned goods for the needy.
Yes,
they are,
yes.
Miss Ella. Today, the Postal Service is collecting canned goods. You can just hang them out on your mailbox.
Yeah, okay.
Thank you for thinking of others, Miss Ella.
Bye-bye. Bye.
Well, guys, I can't believe this 45 minutes
is already. Let me ask you one final question.
Okay.
What something that no one usually tries to grow around? Every year I try to grow something different, and I've got cotton. I'm going to try to grow cotton here this year. What would somebody try to grow that's just a little bit different or unique that you don't, not the cucumber or tomato or something? What would you try?
I think I would. Go ahead, Dave.
Go ahead. Both of
bok choy, pak choy grows well.
What is that?
It's people use it in stir fries.
You have to spell that for me.
P-A-P-A-C, pak choy, and there's bok choy, B-O-C-K or B-O-K.
I just want to see if you know how to spell it.
It's a Chinese vegetable. They grow great. I've got some at home. Oh. I just happen to have a pack of season, and they do really good.
Okay. And what would you drive?
I think I would suggest try kohlrabi. It's an above-ground turnip-like plant.
Yes, yeah, I had some of that before. Yeah, very good. They grow that up at the Amish farm here in Polk County.
We keep the whole county in habaneros. We can grow those.
Yeah, I can grow habanero peppers. I'm very good at that. I don't eat them. I just grow them. Hey, guys, thank you so much.
We had Myron McCleary and Dave Hopper with us today.
This is Make It Grow. It's a joint project of Whoop Radio and the Bradley County Master Gardeners Program. If you'd like to become a Master Gardener here in Bradley County, you need to call the Extension Agent at 728-7001, and they'll put you on a list. They have a class once a year. It's about 16 weeks. Meet one night a week. I've had a ball doing it. Myron is one of the teachers, and Dave's been in the talk. They teach you everything you want to know about it to get you started, at least. And then, if I could just learn half of what you guys know, I'll be okay. If I can get my tomatoes, if I can eat one tomato and get them away from the squirrel this year, I have one this year.
We had a healthy squirrel last year.
Hey, folks, thank you so much.
Thank you, guys.
We'll see you next week here on Make It Grow.
You are listening to WOOP-LP, Cleveland, Tennessee. Whoop FM is a broadcasting service of the Traditional Music Resource Center, and we play America's original music.
You need money overnight, check into cash, your time is tight. Dodge.